So in this lecture, I'm going to be talking about the underlying variance components model that GCTA uses. And it looks like this matrix equation. So here, sigma is the expected phenotypic covariance matrix. So this is an N by N matrix because we've got N individuals in our sample with variances, phenotypic variances down the diagonal and covariances on the off diagonal. And it's going to be decomposed into a genetic bit and a residual bit as well. So the residual bit, which I guess is the easier bit to understand, we just have a single variance component here, sigma squared E, and it is indexed by the identity matrix. So this is ones down the main diagonal and zeros everywhere else. This bit over here is the genetic part of the model. So remember, this is the part that is tagged by SNPs on the microarray. So we have down the diagonal, essentially a measure of the genetic similarity of an individual with themselves. So we would expect that to be one under random mating. And then in the off diagonal, it's those elements of the genetic relationship matrix that we were talking about in the previous lecture. So it's like the genetic correlation between two individuals. So if you imagine in this equation, all we're doing here is we're just multiplying each element of that A matrix by this variance component here, this sigma squared A. And likewise, for the residual part of the model, we are adding a residual variance down the diagonal here, and then combining them both to get this expected phenotypic variance covariance matrix. So at the end of this process, so you can imagine that behind the scenes, GCTA or OpenMX, if we fit the model in OpenMX, is kind of twiddling these parameters around the sigma squared A, the sigma squared E to get the most likely value for them. And when the algorithm reaches its optimum, we get estimates of those variance components. So if we put the additive genetic variance over the sum of the additive genetic variance plus the residual variance, that gives us an estimate of the SNP heritability of the trait. So remember, this is the proportion of phenotypic variance explained by SNPs on the microarray. Now, since most markers on arrays are common, this is primarily going to reflect common genetic variation, but it's also going to include some rare variation that happens to be tagged by the array. So it's not correct to say that SNP heritability is the part of the heritability that's due to common variants. That's absolutely not correct. It's more subtle than that. It's basically all the genetic variation that's tagged by the markers that you're putting into that GRM. And of course, it's important to note that SNP heritability is different from narrow sense heritability that we estimate from twin studies. So SNP heritability, the stuff that's tagged on your microarray, and it's going to be less than your narrow sense heritability, which is what we estimate from twin studies. In the next video, I'm going to talk about the M-GCTA model.